And we find our seats so we can begin our worship service. This is another joyous Lord's Day here in the sanctuary at Pebble Creek. So I say welcome to you and also to those who will worship with us online. May we echo the words that King David said. He joyously said, "I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord." And that's how we're feeling this morning. I encourage you to read the announcements in your bulletin, and I'm just going to highlight them for you, but by reading them, you'll get more details. Today, following our worship, is our annual meeting, and at the annual meeting, members will be voting on the nominees for our various boards, also for our 2023 budget, and our pastor and director of music, search committees will give us an update. Also, we are in need of ushers to pass our offering plates. If you're able to help us with that, please sign up in the back or contact Charlie Newcomer. Also, we're needing pianists for our morning worship service. If you have a gift that you're able to share with us, please contact Shirley Nebergall. Also, our fellowship committee has a spring event for us. If you're interested in attending a preseason baseball game on Saturday, March 25th, sign up in the back and you can also get more details. As always, if you need any counseling, you have any concerns or questions, you can contact Pastor Hal. If you have a prayer request, contact our prayer coordinator, Edna DeFord. Now, as we get deeper into our worship service, with the Lord's power and presence in our lives, let's remove those distracting thoughts. Let's meditate on His goodness. Let's meditate on His greatness. Shirley Nebergall, for her prelude today, has a song that is an American spiritual, and more specifically, it's a Negro spiritual. And maybe we can all be able to say this. Talk about a child that do love Jesus. Here's one. Meditate and be blessed.
Thank you. Well done. If you're able, would you please rise for the call to worship? Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good.
His love endures forever.
Let Israel say,
his love endures forever.
Let the house of Aaron say,
his love endures forever.
Let those who fear the Lord say, you are my God, and I will give you thanks.
You are my God, and I will exalt you.
Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. Please remain standing for the hymn of praise.
Brethren, we have met to worship, to adore the Lord and God. Will you pray with expectation as we preach the living word? All is vain unless the Spirit of the Holy One comes down. God's great blessing will be showered all around. Let us love our God supremely. Let us love our brothers too. Let us pray and care for people till God makes their lives anew.
Morning, everyone. We just had a call to worship that talked about Thanksgiving and thanking God. And I want to read the first verse of Psalm 9. It says, I am thanking you, God, from a full heart. This is David speaking. I'm writing in the book all of your wonders. Turn the page. I am whistling, I'm laughing, I'm jumping for joy, I'm singing your song, Hi God. The pastoral prayer will be a little different this morning in that you got a little piece of paper. Did you all get a piece of paper like this? If you didn't get one, will the ushers please see it? Raise your hand and you will receive one right now. There are lots of hands up. Raise them high. Here they come.
Do we need two pieces?
They're all gone. How can that be? All right. Well, necessity is the mother of invention. Tear off a little piece of paper from the bulletin. Do something. Loan each other a piece of paper. What we're going to do, I'm asking you to write down five things for which you're thankful. Five things for which you're thankful. And I know you're going to say, I don't have a pencil. So let's share pencils. So five things for which you're thankful. Then what's going to happen is when we take the offering, and we're going to do it with offering plates today. How about that? We're going to pass the offering plates. When the plates come by, take your little piece of paper And with your five things, and if you don't have five, write two or three. And put it in the offering plate. And then when you've had your tithes and your offering, in other words, the money that you're giving to the church and to missions around the world, it will be in the offering plate. And also, as an offering to God this morning, your thanksgiving, all the things you're thankful for, will be put in the plate and brought forward and put on the table as an act of a corporate worship of the church, being thankful to God for all he has done for us. And we should be whistling and dancing and jumping for joy for all his goodness to us. And we should also be thankful. Francis Schaeffer, an American theologian, once said, "The key to being Christian is to be thankful." So we're going to have an expression of doing that. And while you're doing that, I'm going to tell you one thing I'm thankful for. I'm thankful for umbrellas. Not necessarily the umbrellas that you pull out of their golf cart when it starts to rain, but the umbrellas like Travelers Insurance used to have. Do you remember they had the ad with the big red umbrella? And you said, come under the umbrella of Travelers, because there you are safe, there you are taken care of, there you have no worries. And we have some great umbrellas that I'd like to mention. One is the church here itself. It is a great protection for all of us as we care for each other in this church and as we are under the umbrella of protection and care of the church. Secondly, we're under the care and protection of Jesus. As we said a couple of weeks ago, nothing can separate us from Christ's love. And so we're under his protection, the umbrella of Christ himself. So as we go to prayer this morning, let's be thankful for the umbrellas that God provides. Let's pray. Lord, I thank you that we can be together this morning. I thank you for the umbrellas of the church and individuals in the church, the care for others that are there for others, that pray for others. We thank you for Edna and the ministry of praying and how people care for each other there. And we thank you that we're under your protection too, Jesus, that you are always there for us. And nothing can separate us from your love and your comfort and your care. I pray now, Lord, that this will be a great offering of thanksgiving as we give, as the collection is taken, as we give these hymns of praise and thanksgiving. In your name we pray, amen. Scripture now. Your turn.
Before I ask you to rise for the Word of God today, I want to talk quickly about context. What I'm reading about today is an excerpt from a letter written by Paul to the people of the Philippian church. He wrote the letter in 61 AD or thereabouts. And since that time, there have been many, many versions of the Bible written. The version I'm reading from today is the English Standard Version. It's loved by Bible students and scholars and people who preach regularly because it goes a little bit deeper into the meaning of the words. For that reason, many of the words will seem out of place to you and I as lay people, but I'm going to read it just like it was written. Would you please rise?
Let's get the mic over closer to you.
Thank you. Finally, my brothers, rejoice in the Lord. To write the same things to you as no trouble to me and is safe for you. Look out for the dogs. Look out for the evildoers. Look out for those who mutilate the flesh. For we are the circumcision, who worship by the Spirit of God and glory in Christ Jesus and put no confidence in the flesh. Though I myself have reason for confidence in the flesh also. If anyone else thinks he has reason for confidence in the flesh, I have more. Circumcised on the eighth day of the people of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of Hebrews, as to the law, a Pharisee, as to zeal, a persecutor of the church, as to righteousness under the law. Blameless, but whatever gain I had, I counted as loss for the sake of Christ. Indeed, I count everything as loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Jesus Christ my Lord. For his sake I have suffered the loss of all things and count them as rubbish in order that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which comes through faith in Christ, the righteousness from God that depends on faith, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and may share his sufferings, becoming like him in his death, that by any means possible I may attain the resurrection from the dead. Please be seated. Would the ushers please come forward for the offering? So much. With our offering today, we give our whole selves to you. Please use it to expand your kingdom and for the expression of thanksgiving that you gave today. May it be a great blessing to many. We ask all this in the powerful name of Jesus. Amen.
Thank you. I'm really sorry about the interruption of sound, but we'll get that straightened up and we'll have you sing again real soon. Maybe at the end of the service. We have real privilege of having one of our own members of the church share with us from the scriptures this morning, Joe Arnold. Is a very unique person in that he has had many different fields of expertise, including being seminary trained as if he were to be a minister. And he, in a sense, is a minister. He and Elizabeth minister to us all the time. And we're really delighted to have Joe here this morning. And let's pray for him as he comes. And Joe, let's just have a prayer here. Joe, may your spirit be in him as he speaks to us. We pray that he will be controlled by the Holy Spirit and that we will gain much that will help us to live better Christian lives. We pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Joe.
Thank you. Good morning. In what do you glory? Many times our self-worth is measured by what we do for a living. Two men meet. Oh, what do you do? Or in a retirement community, what did you do? And one thing that the Protestant Reformation tried to do was break down this isolation between laity and the clergy so that all professions could glorify God by what they did. And I wish I could take credit for mine, but I can't. Some things are done to us and for us, and they're not done by us. Others focus so much on their work that they neglect their family. They neglect devotions with their family. I remember growing up around the breakfast table, our father, my father, who is seminary trained, would lead us in the Psalms or particular reading for that day. And it wasn't only until later in life I really appreciated that. Sometimes our over-dedication to work, however, can be a form of slavery. We want to finish the last memo before we go to bed and all that, before we leave for home, not just go to bed. Sometimes we take our work home with us. I've done that. And aiming to please others can be a form of slavery. When Hal asked me to preach, I told him several weeks ago I was planning on preaching on Galatians chapter 5. And since that time, I've changed it to the current text in Philippians 3 for several reasons. I won't go into all the reasons, but the book of Galatians is our freedom in Christ. And the in the 1200s, there was the British Magna Carta was signed. And Martin Luther, who lived in the 1500s, said that the book of Galatians was the Magna Carta of the Christian faith. And, of course, he said it in German. He didn't say it in English, though. So we don't have to become Jews in order to be Christians. That was the issue in the Galatians. We don't have to be circumcised, and back then it only applied to men. So it doesn't mean that, you know, we're not made holy by doing something for God necessarily. We're made holy only because of what Christ did on the cross. And so this issue of freedom is very important so that Christ can mean something to us. Because in John 10:10 it says, I have come that you might have life and that you might have it more abundantly. So sometimes we have life and we are miserable. We don't inform our faith of the freedom that we have in Christ. And I'm always suspicious of people who say they're free, but they're not joyful. I know that I've provided references for people in my career, you know, people who applied for the government for various things. And this one gentleman worked for me, and the investigator came to me and asked me if he would be a loyal American. And I said, yeah, he came over on a boat from Vietnam. He probably appreciates his freedom more than someone who's lived here all their life. And so freedom is a very important topic, because our enemies would want to restrict our freedom or have us self-censure our freedom. And today I'm going to be talking more of joy. And if you want a book of joy, Philippians is your book. How many have studied Philippians here in the Bible studies? I count several hands. And it's important that we study that. The mark of a free person is that they have gratitude and want to use their freedom to please the one who freed them. Pleasing Jesus should produce joy. Philippians is that book. The city of Philippi that Ed alluded to earlier was named after the father of Alexander the Great. The church there was the first church in Europe that Paul started. So it's a very important city. And the interesting thing is we call the book of Philippians a prison book. It was written when Paul was in prison. And yet the church in Philippi was started when Paul and Silas were thrown into prison. Now the reason that Paul and Silas were in that prison, because they preached against idolatry and the lack of funds caused the uproar in the city that threw them into prison. So in other words, the pagans threw them in prison. The second imprisonment was from the Jews, who wanted to stop Paul from preaching. They wanted to restrict the gospel, so to speak. And we like to have in sermons bullets that start with P, right? Prelude, postlude, all that stuff. It's in our bulletins, it's in our sermons. I thought of one here in one line, I think, Paul's past Philippian prison prelude. Remember how their church was started in Acts 16. That's the story of Paul and Silas. They were singing around midnight, and it says the prisoners were listening. And then there was this earthquake that happened. How many have experienced earthquakes? I know, being from the People's Republic of California, I've been in many of earthquakes. And then the jailer came in, and he was very nervous. He was getting ready to use the short sword. And he says, Paul said, don't do yourself any harm. We're all here. The miracle wasn't necessarily the earthquake. The miracle was that all the prisoners stayed around. And that's what led to the jailer becoming a believer in his house. So that's how the church was started in Philippi. And so if we could look at verse 1, there you go. I'll read that from my Bible, which I brought this morning. Finally, my brothers, rejoice in the Lord. To write these things to you is no trouble to me, and it is safe for you. Paul is going to talk on many more topics before he's done with Philippians, but notice that the word rejoice is in the imperative. It's a command. Rejoice in the Lord. Not just rejoice. Don't just get rejoiced because your back's out of place. Rejoice in the Lord. And I can say that because my back's out of place. So rejoicing in the Lord is commanded. And he's going to write these things to provide a level of safety for the church. And the church was under persecution in that he had some false believers come in that we call Judaizers, who wanted to add to the law of Christ, wanted to add to Christ as being necessary to be saved. And he said, no, you don't have to do that. As he said in Galatians before, over a decade before. That's why I like the book of Philippians. It was written over 10 years after he wrote the book of Galatians. So Paul has not changed the message. He may reword the message a little bit, but he didn't change the message. That's why it's important that we look at the history, the timeline, if you will, of these things. So, the purpose, point A, keep the believers safe from the Judaizers, who said Christ blessed the Jewish laws were needed to be saved. And we've already mentioned that this rejoicing is an imperative. But he goes on in verse 2, look out for the dogs. Why would he call them dogs? I like dogs. We have a service dog in the back. The Orthodox Jews at the time would call the Gentiles dogs. The Orthodox would call them dogs. Dogs were not the pets at that time. They would roam the streets. They were the scavengers. So you can understand the irony that he's saying here. He's saying, these are the dogs, not you. Okay? Look out for the dogs. Look out for the evildoers. These are the ones who claim themselves to be righteous. It was a works righteousness, a self-righteousness. Those who mutilate the flesh, that's circumcision. For we are the circumcision, let's see, verse 2, yeah, we have 2 up there, and 3, who worship by the Spirit of God and glory in Christ Jesus and put no confidence in the flesh. The Jewish Orthodox at the time said in order to worship, you had to go to Jerusalem. That's why you had to appear in Jerusalem at the temple 3 times a year at least. And you couldn't really worship out in the country. You had to go to Jerusalem. That's why in John 4, Jesus talking to the woman of the well, a Samaritan woman at the well, and he says, not here or another place. Is that in the future, you're going to worship God in spirit and in truth. So the physical land was very important to them. The location was very important. Location is important to us. Google knows where you've been shopping. They know from your cell phone where you've been traveling. Location is very important. It matters where that balloon flew over. Okay, to use a modern article. So we're rejoicing in the Lord. We're worshiping by the Holy Spirit. Now, in Philippians in the prior chapter, in verse 13, he said, it is God who works in you both to will and to do of his good pleasure. So even God is putting in our motivations, our actions, in order to please him. So worship is more than just music. We have a worship service. This, preaching of the word, is a form of worship. That's why it's not just music. It's very important. We glory in Christ Jesus. It's the Lord, in verse 1, that we are rejoicing in. Rejoicing in the Lord, verse 1. Glory in Christ Jesus. And put no confidence in the flesh. That's others. That's me. I can't have confidence in my own flesh. As pretty as I think it may look, it looks differently from others. And it's not that pretty. I feel it. Now in verse 4, I want to go on here to verse 4 in Pentateuch B. There's a parenthesis in the text. What do we mean by a parenthesis? We mean it's an aside. Paul is educating the listener on his history as if, you know, many didn't know it. And he was one of them before Christ. He was one of these Judaizers, these Orthodox Jews, before Christ. And in verse 4 through 6, he lists his credentials. Can you still hear me? Okay. Because I can feel my mic coming off. That's why I want to make sure it's still on. Paul counted his past glories, accomplishments, knowledge, religious achievements, law-keeping as worthless. In accounting, he moved his history from the credit to the debit column. Now, we're going to be voting on a budget later. After the service is over, the members are going to stay around and vote on a budget. So it's important that the credit column, the income column, you know, and the expenditures, the salaries, and everything match. So that's why at the bottom line, you want to see what is the bottom line of that report. So Paul changed the way he counts. Okay? I'd recommend a book by Warren Wiersbe, Be Joyful. And in this particular chapter on page 95, the title of it is Learning to Count. He had to count. I'm reminded of a joke where Albert Einstein was taking music lessons, and the instructor, "No, Albert, it's 1, 2, 3, in German, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. So, you know, he had to learn to count differently. Note that all of these, that not all of these were sinful, the things that he's talking about in his resume here. In fact, the best resume you can have is what you ask of your enemies. What do they say about you? It's not just the references I give you, it's those who persecute you. Okay, that's important. And we go to the next point, verse 10 through 11, pursue Christ. Number D there. Yeah. Verse 10. That I may know him, that's Jesus, and the power of his resurrection, and may share his sufferings, becoming like him in his death, that by any means I may obtain the resurrection from the dead. I'm sure Paul knew about Peter's denial of Christ when Christ was on his road to the cross. And he wanted to end his life well. The leaders were the ones that they would persecute first. They would put the people that were out there in the media, they would persecute them first. Just because we don't suffer persecution doesn't mean there's not persecution coming. And Paul wanted to end his life well. The word for resurrection is anastasis. Anastasis. And that's how it's used throughout the New Testament. This last word here for resurrection is not really translated properly. It has an EX before it. It's part of a compound word, they call it. And it's the only place in the New Testament where this applies. Ex anastasis is the word. Ex anastasis. And some translations will say the out resurrection. Paul, in some commentaries, will say he's not referring to every believer. He's just talking about himself. He knew that he was up for the chopping block, that he could go before Caesar and lose his life, and he wanted to witness for Jesus before his demise. What makes me think that? It's always dangerous to develop a whole theology over one word in one place in the Bible. Always dangerous. That's why we compare scriptures. In the life of Paul, I would go to several places. I would go to two things that happened before he wrote this letter, and one time after he wrote this letter to compare Paul's theology. So Paul is reaching, he's pressing to experience a power for witness like Stephen in Acts 7. I'm going to turn there and read it. It's not on your slide, I don't believe. But in starting with verse 48, Stephen is talking here to the Sanhedrin and the Pharisees that are getting ready to stone him. Yet the Most High does not dwell in houses made by hands, as the prophet says, "Heaven is my throne and earth is my footstool." What kind of house will you build for me, says the Lord? Or what is the place of my rest? Did not my hands make all these things? You stiff-necked people, uncircumcised in heart and ears, you always resist the Holy Spirit, as your fathers did, so do you. Which of the prophets did your fathers not persecute? And they killed those who announced beforehand the coming of the righteous one, whom you have now betrayed and murdered. You have received the law as delivered by angels and did not keep it. That's the witness of Stephen to the people who were about to stone him. Later it says that Stephen gazed into heaven, full of the Holy Spirit, saw the glory of God and Jesus standing at the right hand of God. Now, Luke wrote Acts. Luke was not there. Where did he hear that? He heard that from Paul. Paul was there because they put their garments at the feet of Saul. That's the first mention of Saul in the New Testament. So, Saul remembered, even before he was converted, how there was a witness before Stephen was stoned. Okay? So, the normal order is dying and then resurrection. That's why we celebrate Good Friday before Resurrection Sunday, Easter. Okay? In this sense, Paul is trying to steal something from the future, a power, a supernatural power that would give him witness as he stood before Caesar. Now, in case you think that's just extrapolation, not very important, if you turn to 2 Timothy 4, do we have 2 Timothy 4 up? Yeah. Let me turn there too. I want to read it properly. Second Timothy 4, verses 16 through 18. This is the last letter that Paul would write before he was beheaded by Nero. And he's talking at his first defense, that's before Caesar. No one came to stand by me, but all deserted me. May it not be charged against them. But the Lord stood by me and strengthened me so that through me the message might be fully proclaimed and all the Gentiles might hear it. So I was rescued from the lion's mouth. The Lord will rescue me from every evil deed and bring me safely into his heavenly kingdom. To him be glory forever and ever. Amen. Pastor Brian Chappell has said that the will of God will never take you where the grace of God cannot keep you. I think Paul lived that. So we know that even Caesar's household heard the gospel. Paul was given that supernatural strength through the ex-resurrection in order to be that witness. So gifts are good. We receive gifts of the Holy Spirit. And we even, some prayers for the offering will say, we bless the gift and the giver. But what's more important, the gift that God gives us or the giver of that gift who made it all possible? And that's Jesus, who liberated us. So we need to appreciate Jesus for what he has given us and trust in him. The first question of the Scottish Catechism is, what is the chief end of man? Answer, the chief end of man is to glorify God and enjoy him forever. So a better question than what we started the sermon with was, not in what do you glory, but in whom do you glory? Let us pray. Father, help us. We know that we're in some dark days. The dictionaries have changed. Words that we thought we knew are being interpreted differently. Give us a boldness to stand up for you. Give us your grace, O Lord, in the time of need. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's all stand and sing the last. Now, those who know grammar well, sing this the way you read it, not the way you remember grammar. In my heart. May the Lord keep you. May his face shine upon you and give you peace. Go in the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Start shortly.
stay. We'll be starting in just a few minutes. Do you think we're ready to start?
Everybody's anxious to go back in
there. Yes, yes. Grab a cup of coffee and come back and join us. What's that? Do you want to say something, Steve? Maybe they can hear you.